Hey guys, I'm Sudhir Srinivasan, and this is a special episode for Cinema Express. With the 93rd Academy Awards almost upon us this Sunday, I thought it would be a good opportunity to discuss some of the films that have been nominated and, of course, make some predictions and some observations about some of the biggest films that really appealed to me. So yes, let's get on with it. You know, to begin with, I want to start off by talking about how beautiful black and white cinema is. I say this because David Fincher's Mank, Netflix film, paints such a beautiful monochromatic portrait of Herman Mankiewicz, one of the writers of Citizen Kane. It's a film that I like to think of as a dance of shadows. It's a film that I like to think of as an example of the rich visual possibilities that black and white cinema has to offer. And this is why I think I'll be rooting for this film to win the cinematography category in this year's Academy Awards. The only other rival I can think of that could potentially cause an upset in this category to Mank's cinematography is Nomadland. The work in Nomadland, I mean, it's rich and it's visually splendid in terms of how it captures natural locations. And I think it also comes at a time when we are also starved, you know, of the outdoors, that the film itself turns out to be, in a sense, an escape, you know, from the homes that we are once again chained to this year. Mank is a film that secured as many as 10 nominations at the Oscars this year. But even though the protagonist Mank, played by Gary Oldman so convincingly, and I read somewhere that Gary has not had a drink in many years, and you know, in this film he plays an alcoholic so convincingly. But even though the performance is good, and I think I can say that about the performances across this film, I do not see this film winning big at the Oscars, apart from, of course, the technical categories. I say this because I feel like the film lacks an emotional core in the sense and feels a bit indulgent. So yes, I mean, there are many other films that I expect to win in the, say, acting categories or the best film category, and I will be speaking at length about them now. You know, let's begin with the best actor category. And I don't see how the late Chadwick Boseman is not going to win in this category. I say this because his performance as Levy, you know, a musician in the Netflix film Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, is all fire and passion. He's poured so much intensity into this role that it's going to be a hard performance to beat in this category. In particular, there's a 5-minute monologue scene in this film where Chadwick really gets to show what he's capable of. It's a scene in which he narrates a traumatic flashback that's happened to him. He narrates it with the flourish and the finesse of a storyteller. And even if we were to remove this you know, performative portion from this film, he still does so much with what he's given in this film. You know, with minor tilts of his head, with minor shifts in body language, with small gestures, with a hint of laughter. He communicates a range of emotions in this film, you know, as Levy. He immediately gets through to you the vastness of his ambition, of his dreams. And he also manages to get through all the simmering frustration he's been feeling, you know, that has been slowly building within him for years. It's a fantastic performance. As I understand, this is his first ever Academy Award nomination in this category, and unfortunately his last, considering he's passed away. And I really don't see how he's not going to win it this year. And you know, everything points at him winning the Best Actor, making him, as I understand, the third actor to win in this category posthumously. Through Chadwick Boseman, I think if we were to say that life is speaking to us about transience, through another nomination in the same category, and I'm talking about Sir Anthony Hopkins' stellar performance in one of the nominations in this year, a film called The Father. We must remember that this actor is 83 years old, and he delivers an absolute acting masterclass in this film. The film itself deals with the difficult subject of aging. It speaks of the forgetfulness caused by you know, conditions that debilitate you as you grow old. And it's a frightening film. It's a frighteningly honest film. So as I was saying, if life speaks to us about transience through Chadwick Boseman, I think through Anthony Hopkins, it speaks to us about endurance, about longevity. about his performance in this film. I mean, one must remember that the one time Anthony Hopkins won the Academy Award was way back in the 90s, and he did it for, of course, his performance in Silence of the Lambs. If we think about the characters from that film and The Father, they're absolutely not comparable, because the character in Silence of the Lambs is that of a ruthless man, is that of a man who's capable of great cunning and great conviction when he wants to unleash evil. And in this film, he's anything but that. He's a good man. He's an absolute poster boy for uncertainty. He's not sure about his environment. He's not sure about the relationships around him. I mean, hell, he's not even sure about his own identity. It's a performance so good that if it were any other year, I have no hesitation in saying that this is a performance that is deserving of the highest recognition. And if this were any other year, I think Sir Anthony Hopkins would have been a shoo-in to win under this category. And in fact, I would go so far as to even suggest that if he and the late Chadwick Boseman were to share the Best Actor Oscar, I think that would be totally justified. I mean, such is the excellence of the performances of these two actors that I haven't even started talking about another powerful performance in the Best Actor category nominees. I'm talking, of course, about Riz Ahmed and his performance in the film The Sound of Metal. In the film, the actor plays a vulnerable drummer who struggles to deal with, his loss of hearing. And quite naturally, he does not get a lot of lines in this film. However, his eyes, those expressive eyes of Riz Ahmed's, they do so much talking in this film. They tell you many a story about the suffering that he's undergoing internally. And it's fascinating if you think about it. All these three actors and their respective characters that I've just spoken of, in a sense, it feels to me that they can all be compared. I'm talking about their vulnerability. They're all vulnerable characters, and I'm talking about how much suppressed pain they have, and how much their love is stifled in a sense. While I'm talking about suppressed anguish, how do I not speak about the excellent Viola Davis's performance in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom? It's a character that that outwardly looks very angry. I mean, she even comes across as a very haughty character. But watch her during those quiet moments where she lets her guard down, probably out of sheer fatigue, and you will see the woman that she actually is versus the woman that she's, that she's trying to be to get by in society. If the late Chadwick can be said to be the yin of this film, then Viola Davis's performance has got to be the yang in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. And if it were any other year again, I would say that Viola Davis should be a favorite in this category, and she probably still is. But a lot of the Academy Award predictions are often made considering previous patterns that have been established over the years in this award ceremony. I say this because it's usually very rare for the same film to have to win both the Best Actor and the Best Actress categories. If I remember right, I think it last happened in 1998 for when Jack Nicholson and Helen Hunt won under these categories for the film As Good As It Gets. So, maybe one of the other nominees, someone like Frances McDormand, who plays the protagonist in the film Nomadland, maybe she can, she is likely to win this award under this category. I say this because her performance is also splendid in this film. Be it her rebellious, even something like the rebellion of her hair in this film, and the wrinkles on her face, they feel like characters in this film, given how the film is in no hurry to get places, just like the nomads that it's speaking about in the film. There are also a couple of other strong performances in this category. Carey Mulligan, one of the nominees, for example, plays Cassandra in the film Promising Young Woman. She plays an avenging angel that's, bad news for sexual predators, and in the post-Me Too era, this could be a film that could really cause quite an impact on the Oscar voters. The other performance I'm talking about here is of Andra Day. She plays the singer Billie in the film United States versus the Billie Holiday. It's a film in which her character helps push forward the black civil rights movement a lot. But even considering all these factors and all the strength of these performances, I think Nomadland and Frances McDormand should be walking away with this one. I think Matters are fairly straightforward in the best supporting actor category. I say this because actor Daniel Kaluuya, one of the five nominees, his performance in Judas and the Black Messiah looks certain to win under this category. He plays a character called Fred Hampton. He's a revolutionary socialist and the chairman of the Black Panthers group. It's a film set in the past and that is based on a lot of real events, and this character itself is a real person and a phenomenal orator, and it's those portions in the film that really convince you. When you're watching Fred Hampton speak in this film, you're not just listening, you're following. In fact, one of the characters who's hired to work against Fred Hampton in this film, in Judas and the Black Messiah, even he finds it difficult to resist the charms of Fred. Such is his persuasive power in this film. And while speaking about persuasiveness, how do I not speak of another nominee in this category? I'm speaking of Paul Racy, who's played, who plays a deaf wise man in the film Sound of Metal. I mean, in The Sound of Metal, it's astonishing how much Paul does, given the constraints of this role, and how much control he exercises over this film, given his limited screen time. There's one other strong performance in this category, and I'm speaking about Leslie Junior's performance in One Night in Miami, a film that I think deserved a lot more nominations than it has secured. Leslie's biggest achievement in this film is being able to hold his own and being able to survive arguments with someone as charismatic as Malcolm X in this film. And for those of you who are not familiar with who Malcolm X is, I suggest you do a lot of reading. And once you do that, maybe if you haven't watched the film, please do check out this wonderful film. I'm speaking about One Night in Miami. But anyway, returning to this category, I'm not sure though if Leslie has done enough to beat Daniel Kaluuya's performance in this category. So my vote would go for Daniel in this category. Now let's move on to the supporting actress category, and as you can imagine, there are some eye-catching performances, and I think towering above them, above all the nominees in this category, is Yujin Yoon, who plays a rather energetic grandmother in the film Minari. I mean, it's a character, if you've seen the film, it's a character you're not going to be forgetting in a hurry, and much of the credit goes to the actress for that. And if she were to win in this category, I understand that she becomes only the sixth person ever to win for a role that predominantly has non-English dialogues. I mean, the film itself, I'm speaking about Minari now, it's a film that has a lot of Korean dialogues. It speaks of immigrants and their way of life and what it takes for them to belong in a space. And it has a lot of metaphors as well. And it's a film that is apparently quite adored by the Academy this year, which is probably why it has as many as 6 nominations. But I do think that it's in this category that it stands the strongest chance of winning something. As for the other performances in this category, there's of course Glenn Close, who delivers a typically excellent performance, even if her film Hillbilly Elegy can't be said to be excellent. But I think the performance that stands a real chance of springing an upset in this category. I think if we were to speak of someone who could potentially cause an upset in this category, I think we'll have to speak of Maria Bakalova, the actress who made her debut in the satirical comedy Borat subsequent movie film. I mean, it's a by now there have been several anecdotes about how while making this film, she put herself in harm's way, and she almost got arrested by the police. And I'm sure if you check out the making of Borat, you may unearth a lot more fascinating stories. But apart from that, her character I see as being very important to this film. You could even argue that if this movie were, if you can say that this movie has an emotional core at all, then it has to be the character played by her. It's a character that speaks. I mean, that's participative in making many a criticism against issues like sexism, misogyny, xenophobia. I mean, you name it, there's a film that deals with it all, and her character is at the heart of it all. But the question is, does comedy get taken seriously at the Academy? As we've seen in previous years, not so much. So that may weigh against her performance. But my personal favorite, and I do have one in this category, is of Olivia Colman, who's been nominated for the movie The Father. It's a very difficult role. She plays the daughter of a man who's sort of losing his grip on life itself, and it's a character that goes through many a conflict. It's a daughter who's guilt-ridden throughout the film about some choices, some tough choices that she's forced by situation to make. And much like Paul Racy in Sound of Metal, in this role Olivia Colman does so much, given the limited scope that even some scenes offer. Say for example, there is a very passing scene that occurs in an elevator. When Olivia Colman and Sir Anthony Hopkins, they're both in an elevator, and he asks her about whether she's done something to her hair and goes on to appreciate it. Just focus on how much Olivia communicates in that scene. She moves from being defensive to being surprised that he's paying her a compliment, to being happy that he's paid her a compliment. And then immediately she regains composure before she again feels guilty about what she's about to do to him. And all these changes in reactions happen, and she communicates so much over a course of few seconds. It's terrific. And now let's move on to the best director category this year. Quite fascinatingly, Danish director Thomas Vinterberg has won himself a nomination under the best director category for his film Another Round. It's a film I had the privilege of catching at a festival, and it's a fantastic film. But I do find it difficult to believe that the director is going to win it under this category. I do think that the film should be winning comfortably in the foreign film category. The film speaks about a bunch of men who take it upon themselves to perform an experiment of sorts. I mean, they try to get drunk every day to see whether it improves the quality of their lives. The bigger picture that the film speaks about, the bigger point the film speaks is about being awakened into life, as the director himself has mentioned in quite a few interviews. But yes, as I said, I do find it hard to believe that this director is going to be winning in a category where, Fincher has poured in a lot of auteur touches into Mank, where Emerald Fennell has shown such conviction and intensity of the topic she handles in Promising Young Woman, or where Lee Isaac Chung has dealt in such wonderful sensitivity and subtlety with his film Minari. Or last but not the least, Chloe Zhao, and how she has communicated so much in Nomadland communicated so much without resorting to the use of dialogues and the commentary she makes about capitalism and what we've taken for granted must as our objectives in life. She asks all sorts of questions in this film. So yes, I do find it difficult to believe that Thomas is going to win in this category. So who is going to win under this category, you ask? My bet will have to be on Chloe, mainly because she has sort of swept all the directorial honors in the previous awards leading to the Oscars. And also because it's a film that is very resonant of the time that we find ourselves in, and at a time when the rich and poor divide is particularly greater than it has ever probably been. And it is also to be noted in another category, the editing category, while we are speaking about that category, it must be noted that following in the footsteps of legendary directors like Ethan Coen, James Cameron and Alfonso Cuarón, Chloe also becomes a director to be nominated in the editing category for her work in Nomadland as well. However, I don't see her winning in this category, mainly because she has some very strong rivals in the nominees. And I'm mainly thinking of editor Fredrik Thorvald's work in Promising Young Woman, or even Mr. Nielsen's work in Sound of Metal. Promising Young Woman thrives in its use of music to communicate the emotions of its protagonist and the intensity of her vengeance. While Sound of Metal, which I think to be the favorite in this category, in the editing category, does so much to make you feel what the protagonist must be going through. As the protagonist loses his sense of hearing and struggles with it, It's incredible how, with the use of sound, this film paints such a vivid picture of what life must be like for a person like him. And I can tell you, it's frightening. It's genuinely scary to be able to, you know, it happens very rarely. We've seen many films deal with the topic of deafness. We've seen many films deal with such conditions, but this film approaches it in a very personal way, and makes you feel a rich sense of belonging to the protagonist that I doubt that you're going to have as immersively frightening an experience as this film presents to you. And it is for that reason that I think this film stands a good chance of winning it in the editing category. So now we move on to, of course, the prized best film category. There are a total of about 8 films nominated in this category, and you know, 7 of them I've already mentioned while speaking about the other categories. So the one film that I haven't spoken about or mentioned yet is The Trial of the Chicago 7, that has also been nominated in the best film category. Now, as for the best film, I do think that, you know, given the world that we live in today, given the capitalistic greed that surrounds us, given, as I spoke about, the rich-poor divide that is increasingly evident to us, I do think that the signs are all pointing towards Nomadland winning it in this category. It is worth noting though that in the lead up to the Oscars, there has been mounting criticism against Nomadland, with people speaking about how it glosses over Amazon's treatment of its workers in this film. But then again, I'm not really sure if the Academy really pays attention to criticism like this. Because we just need to remember that about a couple of years back, was it, when the Oscar, the best film was given to The Green Book, even though there was a lot of criticism over, you know, how it whitewashed the topic of racism. Even though the film I'm going to be speaking about now, even though this film I do not see winning in the best film category, for reasons I've already mentioned to you, my favorite of all the 8 films, and the one that gave me the greatest satisfaction, is this film. And I'm speaking about The Father. You know, in many films, we've seen them use the rather gimmicky device of the unreliable narrator. But in The Father, this device comes to use so relevantly. It's a device that assists in making you really feel the experiences that Anthony Hopkins' character, interestingly named Anthony, goes through in this film, and you really get a sense of the loss of identity he's feeling and how unreliable his memory has turned out to be. In one scene especially, it's very chilling when Anthony warns you that you know, all this can happen to you as well, much faster than you can imagine it would. So in that sense, it's a film that really warns us that none of us are impervious to the effects of physical decline and eventual mental decline as well. And it's a scary thought. Father also speaks about the loss of home, you know, at a time when a lot of people are losing their jobs and feeling, you know, becoming homeless. And, you know, we are seeing it day in and day out on the newspapers. The father is as relevant to the times as a Nomadland is, and a film like The Father will, I suppose, you know, given the heavy existential topics that it deals with, I don't see it going out of relevance anyway. Usually during times of a pandemic, during times when, you know, the majority of the society seems to be struggling, there's always the question of, you know, why films are important. And I'll tell you why. It's because it's only through films, not just films, through art generally, that we find some solace from all the suffering around us. It's through art that we realize what we are taking for granted, and, you know, spaces where we should aspire to do better. Films and art reminds us of that. Good films and good art reminds us of that constantly. Hey, and you know, while an awards function that's as popular as the Oscars also serves to remind you of films that we might have missed, you know, over the last year and a half. There's just so much content out there on theaters, on OTT platforms, on the television, that it's just impossible to catch every good content, every good film that comes out there. And I also see this as an opportunity to speak with you about some of these films, and personally to discover some of them. And if you, like me, always sift through the nominations, the Oscar nominations, looking for some progress, some development, I think this year there is quite a bit to be happy about. As I understand, it's the first time that two women are being nominated under the Best Director category. And the Best Actor category, if you'll just look at some of these names and read up about them, you'll realize that there's a lot of diversity there as well. And it's also, I also find it heartwarming that among the nominees is one 89-year-old costume designer called Anne Roth. And there's of course the 83-year-old Sir Anthony Hopkins, who does not seem to be getting old at all, even if his role in The Father tells you otherwise. You know, so yes, I mean, the Oscars may be a pop culture phenomenon, but if you're looking for some hope, some inspiration in these times, then some of these films that are nominated could offer you some of that. So with that, I think I'll wrap up this fairly extensive, even by my standards, segment about the special segment about the Oscars that are set to happen this Sunday. I will also be looking out to see if some of these predictions match up with what happens. And I hope that if you haven't caught some of these films, you get an opportunity to do so. And if you have any comments to make about any of these films or this video, feel free to leave it, and I'm sure we can have a chat about that. My name is Sudhir Srinivasan. Thank you so much for watching this video. And if you like this video, do hit like. And if you want to see more of these videos, do subscribe to our channel. Thank you so much. I'll talk to you soon.